How's it going, everybody? Welcome back. Today, what we're going to be talking about is how to build a loft bed with no supports on the bottom whatsoever, or how I did it at least. There may be different ways to do it, but this is the way that I did it. My last video, I built this deck on the front, so look at that video if you want to see how this one was built, but let's get started on this bed. All right, so what I want to put up is a twin size bed, and the measurements for a twin size bed, I had to look it up, was about 38 inches by 75. So I want to go about 40 inches, give it that extra 2-inch space just to be able to maneuver it around so it's not so tight. If you could recall when I actually installed the drywall, you could remember that I put some blocking on the backside of the drywall itself. So there's actually blocking a 2x6 piece between studs with extra support studs underneath that blocking. And that was 69 inches high. So I remember that measurement. That's why it's very important to write that stuff down so you remember in the future when you're going to place like a loft bed like this in. You want to make sure that you remember that measurement. So I went ahead and made my marking 69 inches high as well. So that's going to be pretty much the bottom area, near the bottom area of my actual bed. So I went ahead and made my markings on each wall, all the measurements. I remember that there's a blocking on each corner of the back side of the wall, as well as exactly the same on the opposite side of the wall on the side walls. There's 2x6s between studs there. So the next step I took was cutting the pieces of 2x6 to make the frame of the bottom of the bedside. So what you have to take into consideration is the thickness of your 2x6s. Now the thickness is 1.5 inches. So if you are making 40 inches, you have got to factor that 1.5 inches on each side in. So that's going to make 3 inches. So if you're making your sides between the long portion that goes and on the back side of the wall and the long portion that goes on the front side of the wall, you've got to make them 37 inches. That way, when you frame the actual bed frame itself, it comes out to exactly 40 inches. If you decided to make the sidings the full length of 40 inches, then your rear portion, the long portion that goes against the back side of the wall, the long 2x6, has got to be cut down, and you need to take those into consideration, the two 2x6 pieces with 1.5 inches on each side. So whatever length you're going, you have got to still factor in that 1.5 inches to make your cut and the frame fit in perfect. And that goes for both the front and the back piece. So whatever you decide to do, it could be either way. So if you wanted the sidings to be 40 inches, and you have got to factor in that your back portion and your front portion have got to have that 1.5 inches on each side factored in to make that cut. If you decide to put the back side and the front side long ways from corner to corner, then you're going to have to factor that in for your 2x6 pieces to be cut shorter and the 1.5 inches on each side. So what I decided to do was to make my sidings at 37 inches. I wanted my back piece against the wall and the front piece at the front of the bed to be the full length. Now, here's a little trick that I use when I want to get a perfect measurement. I know my measuring tape is 3 inches long. So I put my measuring tape from corner to corner, and whatever the measurement shows, I add 3 inches to that to get an exact measurement. Now, once I had my two pieces cut for the back side and the front side, this is not really necessary, but I wanted the lag bolts to sink into the board so that they're not sticking out. Now, that's more used for if it's going to be really shown or if anybody's going to be walking near it, but this is not necessary. It's just something I chose to do. Now, my recommendation when doing a project like this is to get yourself a stud finder. What a stud finder does is pretty much self-explanatory what it says. It tells you where the studs are. Once I found my studs, I was able to make my height mark. Once I made my height mark, I went ahead and used a level and made a line straight across the bottom so I know where my 2x6 is going to lay. So what I'm doing now is I'm finding the exact measurement from the corner of the wall to where that stud is at. What I'm doing there is transferring that number onto this back 2x6 piece. And then I'm going to put a screw, start a screw off onto the actual 2x6, And that way, when I put this 2x6 up, I already have a screw ready to go right on the marking, and I just have to drill it in, and it should attach to that stud on the back side of the wall. Now, don't worry about if this is not leveled off when you first put this first screw in. The reason I'm putting it in the middle is so that I can adjust it with a level when I'm ready to put the other bolts in. Once you have that back 2x6 piece on, I went ahead and threw the level up on top to make this board completely leveled, and it's going to be ready to get screwed in. Now, I know that this is not exactly the best angle to see what I'm doing here, but what I am doing is driving a lag bolt into the 2x6 and into the blocking on the back side of the wall. Just remember, every time or any time you're using a lag bolt, you want to make sure that you have a pilot hole first. So the way to figure that out is basically just get us one size smaller than the lag bolt with that actual drill bit, and it'll go in perfectly fine. Now that I have one lag bolt in one corner of this board, I'm checking my level again to make sure everything is completely leveled off. I don't have to make any adjustments. I still have to do the other side. Okay, and a little bit better of an angle here so you can see what I'm doing. I'm using a drill with a drill bit to make a pilot hole into the hole that I'm going to put the lag bolt into. Now, I recommend getting an adapter for the socket that's going to fit around the lag bolt and get that lag bolt into this board. However, I could not find my adapter to save my life. So what I had to do was use a regular old socket wrench here in order to get this lag bolt in. However, during the remainder of the project, I had gone to the store to get an adapter. I just could not find the one I had, but this works perfectly fine too. It's just the adapter with a drill makes the job so much easier and so much quicker. I do believe that the adapters run only about $3, $4, depending on the brand that you're getting, depending on the quality. They're really not that expensive, and it saves so much more time. But as you can see, with those two lag bolts in there, this thing is holding up tight. I then went ahead and used my stud finder again to find all the studs on the back side of this wall, transferred that number over to the 2x6, and drilled some good old deck screws into the 2x6 and into those studs. And don't forget about your corners, the ending pieces of this 2x6. There are studs on each corner of the wall, or at least there should be studs on each corner of this wall. You have to remember that the drywall had to get attached to something at one point, so you have to know that there's studs back there somehow. So don't forget about those and make sure you hit all your studs. The same exact process applies to the sidings as well. You want to make sure you're using a stud finder to find all your studs, make the marking, get that measurement from the corner to where that stud is at, and then go ahead and transfer that number onto your 2x6, the side pieces, that way you can start a screw into it. Now, if you had somebody else helping you out, this would not really be a necessary step. They could hold the 2x6 piece up against the wall, and you just have to follow the marking wherever your stud finder showed you where a stud was at, and you could just drill it in. However, I didn't have that other set of hands, so I had to make my marking, put a screw into the board. That way, when I put it up, it's so easy to drill in. Don't forget to use your level in order to make sure you have a level line, and make sure that it's on the bottom side of the 2x6 so that you can actually see where you're leveling this off at. So again, use the level from the corner of the bottom of the corner of that 2x6 against the wall, make your line, and that way when you put your 2x6 up, it's so much easier to make sure that it's level with just that line. Double checking my level, making sure that everything's leveled off, making sure that everything's straight. Couldn't get any easier to install these boards. Now, even though I am installing these boards right now with some deck screws, even though deck screws are great and they are very strong, they're not as strong as lag bolts. So I will be taking some of the screws out to replace them with lag bolts. All right, so here are my three boards installed so far, the backboard and the two sides. Now, I'm going to use a level right now to make sure everything's leveled off. If done correctly, the last board we put on, the front portion of the frame, should be leveled off if installed the right way. I highly recommend in a 4-foot level or anything somewhat similar to that size. Now, 8-foot levels are great, but sometimes they don't exactly work within the space that you have. So it doesn't really matter the brand that you buy. All you need to do is make sure that you actually have one for this project. Now, You can see everything is leveled off. You can see the middle portion of this level. It shows the bubbles right in the middle between those lines. That's exactly what we want. And now we are ready to move on to the next step. So the way that I installed the front portion of the frame was I went ahead and installed two screws into each ending of this 2x6. Now keep in mind, these screws are not going to be the only things holding this board up. It's just to get this board up so I can continue to work on this project. So I do apologize, I wish I was looking at my camera to see what I was doing at the time, or at least where it was facing. I got more of the left side than the right side, but as you can see here, it's pretty self-explanatory. All I'm doing is installing these screws, screwing these screws into the ends of those sidings. That's it. Make sure that it's leveled off. Just double check with your level, make sure everything's leveled, and as you can see, the bubble is right in the middle of those two lines, right on the level. That's exactly what we want. The boards are all nice and flushed, everything looks great, and we're ready to continue on with the project. Before I continue on, I want to make sure that the back portion and the front portion are leveled off as well. And as you can see, as we explained before, the bubble has to be between those two lines in order to be leveled. I'm just running the level all the way down the frame, making sure that that bubble stays in the middle. And if it does all the way from one side to the other side, then we are exactly where we want to be and it's perfectly leveled off. That's what we want. Now that we have the frame installed, there are still many more steps we need to take. We need to make sure that this thing is fastened in as tight as possible so that no matter how much weight we put on here, it will never come down. I'm going to show you how I did this. I'm going to show you that it works. All right, as I mentioned before, we're going to remove some of these deck screws. Now, we already have a pilot hole basically made for us with these deck screws. So all we have to do is make sure that we're removing some of them and then install the lag bolts in their place. And as you can see, I went to the store and got myself an adapter for the drill. Makes the job so much easier, so much quicker, rather than just using a socket set. So just make sure you're putting at least one lag bolt per stud. And now it's time to get the joists installed, at least cut out at this point. It's very simple, the same exact technique to use. Put the ending of your measuring tape against one side and the other end against the other side, and add 3 inches to whatever measurement's showing. So because I wanted this thing very strong, obviously based on the fact that there's no support on the bottom, I need to make sure that my joists are nice and strong. I'm putting 16 inch on centers on all my joists. I did the same thing with both the back and the front, and just keep in mind, 16 inch on centers plus or minus 3/4 of an inch, make your line, that way the board sits against that line and your 16 inch on center is right on mark. All right, so here's the corner bracing that I'm using. This is a thick plate right here. It almost looks like a hinge, but it's very thick and this one does not move. It does not bend inwards or outwards. It's just a complete 90 degree turn. One important thing that you have to pay attention to is the size lag bolt that you're using for this ending portion of the frame. Remember that the thickness of that board is 1.5 inches, so the lag bolt cannot be more than 1.5 inches, otherwise when screwed in, it's going to pop out on the other side. Alright, so just a reminder, when using lag bolts, you need to make sure that you're making pilot holes. They're not the same as screws where you can just screw things in sometimes, or the deck screws that don't require pilot holes. These require pilot holes. Just use a drill, the drill bit, make your pilot holes, and then get ready to put those lag bolts into the bracing. And it's really just this simple to install these. Again, that adapter helps out so much more than just using a regular socket set. So in this example here, I'm showing you how to put in 2 lag bolts into this bracing. However, there are 6 holes altogether and all of them are going to be filled. All right, so you can see that they're all installed now. Every hole has a lag bolt and every corner has a bracket. All right, so I went ahead and got my joists ready. Again, they should be 37 inches, just like the sidings, based on the fact that those are between the back and the front boards. So they should be 37 inches each. However, what I did was set up a stop block, that way I don't have to keep remeasuring. Some people may have their own techniques, I'm sure they do. However, I found it very easy to do this by using a clamp. It's a lightweight clamp, and all it's doing is holding flushed one side of the 2x6 joist. That's all I need. Just hold one side so I can get the other side screwed in and move on to the other one. I'm then going to go ahead and place that ending of the 2x6 flushed with the siding of this 2x6, and we're just going to go ahead and put some screws in. Now keep in mind, when using these screws, it doesn't matter if you're using exterior or interior screws, because this should never have water on it. Now, I'm using exterior deck screws just based on the fact that I still had these for the project. It does get somewhat tricky when you don't have a line to go off of and you're screwing in the screws. It may come out the side of the 2x6. If needed, just use a speed square, line it up in the middle of that 2x6 and make a straight line. On the opposite end where the clamp was initially, I'm going to go ahead and install some joist hangers. Keep in mind, we're using 2x6 pieces of wood here, so we need to make sure we're using 2x6 joist hangers. Now looking down this 2x6, you could tell the ending has a little bow in it, but it's going to work just fine. I'm going to go ahead and continue the same process for each joist. I'm going to place the clamp at one end, make sure it's flushed on one end. Maneuver the other end of the 2x6 to wherever I need to, right on the line where I made the marking on the 16 inch on center, and then go to the opposite end where the clamp is at and put the joist hanger. Another way you can do it as well is not just place one clamp on one side. You can actually clamp both sides if you feel that's more necessary to do and you feel that it's going to be more lined up for you. Whatever you decide to do, that's your decision. And here's a quick view of the inside with my clamps in place. I know it's hard to tell, but they are lined up right on my 16 inch on centers. Another route you could take as well is if you put the screws in on one side and you want to leave the clamp in on the opposite side, you can always put a screw on the top diagonally from the top portion of that 2x6 into that back flush 2x6 against the wall. And then go ahead and install your joist hangers. Like I said, there's many ways to do this. And here's the ending result with the joist hangers on one side of the frame. However, I still need to continue the joist hangers on the opposite side where I was initially putting the two screws in. Now, since we know that a 2x6 is actually an inch and a half thick, we need to make sure that we're using something smaller than an inch and a half so the screw or the nail doesn't come out the opposite end. So what I'm going to go ahead and use here are inch and a quarter screws. Now again, if you're using nails, you want to make sure that it's something that's smaller than an inch and a half. Just that way that the point of the nail does not come out of the end of the wood and you don't leave any sharp points at the end. So keep in mind, the corner brackets are also going to be the same. Now, it doesn't matter what size you're using going towards the wall. It matters what size you're using going out of the actual frame itself. You want to make sure that none of the screws or the nails, the points of them, are coming out of that wood. And here's the finalized piece of the framing itself. So all the joists are in place, all the joist hangers are in place, all the corner brackets are in place, or the angle brackets, whatever you want to call them. Everything is strapped in now, and this thing is solid. As you can see, I can hang on this thing and it won't budge. Now it's time to make some additional strength for this thing. What I'm going to go ahead and do is install some blocking. Now, in order to do the blocking, I need to make sure that I have all the measurements between the joists. Now, they should all be the same except for the two endings where they're smaller. Now, this does not need to be exact. You can use a chalk line if you wanted to with this. If you had another person holding it or you wanted to install a screw on one side and pull a chalk line. However, what I'm doing here is getting somewhat of a happy medium between my joists. And then with that measurement, I'm going to go ahead and use my speed square and make a line on both sides of the joist hangers, including the bottom. That way I can stagger the blocking and they're going to be lined up. Now when I make my cuts for the blocking on the 2x6s, I want to make sure I'm doing this one by one. That way each blocking gets its screws and nails in or whatever you want to put in there, and everything's lined up the way it needs to be. So as mentioned before, it doesn't matter if you're using screws or nails for this. The only reason I'm actually using nails is just based on the fact that the batteries for my drill burned out and I needed to charge them. So That's why I'm using nails. I didn't want to stop the whole project just because I had a charger battery. So again, that's the only reason why I'm using nails, but you can use nails or screws. It doesn't matter. Now, when I mentioned the staggering pattern, this is exactly what I meant. So you have one block on one side of the line, and when you go on to your next block to between the next pair of joists, you want to make sure it staggers, so you're going to place it on the opposite line. The same line, but on the opposite side, I'm sorry. So once you place that in, it should be perfectly lined up. That's the reason you don't want to just make a mark, and you actually want to make a line so the edge of that 2x6 can line up flush with that line and it'll be straight. And again, using nails or screws, it doesn't matter. However, I'm using nails here, and all you're going to do is put two nails in on each side of the 2x6. That's all you need for this to make the blocking work. Again, this is just adding strength. It has nothing to do with the framing portion itself. When you reach the end portion, the 2x6 that's near the wall, now you can see part of my 2x6 kind of busted off based on the fact that it hit one of the lag bolts, but it's not going to affect it at all. But in order to keep it from moving, you need to make sure that you're going to hit the diagonals. But in order to keep it from moving, you can either put a screw or a nail in from the bottom or from the top or from both. It doesn't matter. That way it keeps it in place when you actually put the diagonal ones in from the side. All right, so looking down the line, you can see the staggering of the blocking. That's exactly what we want. That's the only way to be able to put this blocking in unless you install some joist hangers on each and every one of them, but that's not necessary when you could do it this way. Now, these blockings itself, again, it's just adding extra strength to the frame itself. That's it. You don't have to be so concerned to where these blockings are when installing the plywood on the top or the bottom, just based on the fact that what you are actually going to be screwing into are the joists that are coming from the back side to the front side. You're not going to be screwing into the blocking. Now, if you wanted to do that extra screw into the blocking, then you could do that, and you just have to figure out where the blockings are at, but that's not necessary. Now it's time to get started on the plywood. So we're going to bring it out to an area where we can actually cut it. Now, what you're going to want to do is measure out to whatever size you made your frame. So I made mine again at 40 inches just based on the fact that a twin bed is usually about 38 inches. So I wanted to give that extra 2 inch just so I could fit the mattress in there. And that way it's not a completely tight squeeze or even have some comforters over it. Again, that's what I'm making my measurements at 40 inches. Now, there's a couple ways to do this. If you have a circular saw and you don't have some sort of guide, then I would recommend doing it this way by getting some sort of straight edge that is long enough to go across one end to the other. Here, fortunately, I have an 8 foot level. The 8 foot level will make it work. Again, this is one way to do it. Another way to do it is obviously to use a table saw. However, what I'm going to be using is a Craig rip cut, and basically what it's going to do is it's going to act as a guide. Wherever I make my marking and place my blade against that marking, it's going to make a cut. I'm going to show you that exact tool right now. I would highly recommend in purchasing a tool like this. It helps out tremendously. It eliminates a table saw when you don't have to pull one out, or if you don't have one already stationary. If you have one stationary already, it might be easier to work with. But again, all you need to hook up is your Craig rip cut, put it on your circular saw, your worm drive, whatever you're using, line the blade up to the mark, put the guide up, lock it in place, and make your cut. Makes a perfect straight cut every single time. And don't forget, we need to cut the length as well. So whatever your length is, so mine is from one wall to the other wall, or for the corner of the frame to the corner of the frame, whatever you want to call it. But whatever it is, it has to be the length. You want to make sure you make that cut. Once the length and the width were cut to the exact size, I went ahead and brought the plywood into the structure and placed it on top of the frame itself. Now, this plywood does not need to be the smoothest plywood in the world, just based on the fact of what I am going to do. I'm going to go ahead and place some wood flooring, or the laminate wood flooring, on top of it once I'm all done. However, if you do not want to put wood flooring on top and you're going to leave it just like this, you want to make sure you get something that's smoother on top so it doesn't leave any splinters or the kids don't get anything in their hands and it doesn't tear any material that's going to be on top of there. Now, as you can see, the plywood is cut to the exact length and width and everything is flushed up. This is the way that you want it. You want to make sure that it's flushed up and tight against the walls, not too tight to where it's ripping into the paint. However, tight enough to where when you put stuff up there, nothing's gonna fall through the cracks. Now, before I move on to the next portion, I wanna make sure that I'm gonna move this plywood outwards. That way I can get to the backside and mark my joists. Now, I could have done this before. However, I forgot about doing this, so I had to move my plywood back and make my marking. So I'm just making a small little marking against the wall area. I know it's gonna be covered up later on, but just a small enough marking so I know where my joist is at on one side. And I'm gonna do the same thing with the opposite side so I can make a straight line and I know where my nails or screws are gonna be placed. Now for the bottom side, I wanted to make sure that I got a smooth enough plywood that's gonna look good. I'm not planning on covering this up or even painting this, so I wanna make sure I have a smooth plywood. Now, this is very tough to do by yourself, so luckily my ladder fit perfectly underneath it to give me that extra support, but I highly recommend in having somebody else help you out with this. If you need to make any small adjustments because the plywood is coming out on one side, just use a piece of wood to be able to knock it back in. You don't want to use hammer onto the plywood because you're going to start chipping at it. So the best way to do anything like that to make those small adjustments is just to place a block against whatever side you need to go back further and hit it with a hammer and it should move for you. The only reason it wouldn't move for you is if you didn't cut it to the right size and it's just pushing against the wall. So your main goal on this portion here is to get all the screws into all the joists. That's why you want to make a line from one end of the joist to the other end and make sure that it's perfectly straight so you can run down that line with all your screws and you won't have any issues of guessing where the joists are actually at. So as you can see before, I went ahead and put some screws in before I made my lines. That way I could just hold it up. I don't want to leave this ladder supporting the entire plywood by itself. So I was able to hit some screws into certain joists just to make sure that it holds up for the time being. I then went ahead and made my straight lines from one side of the joist to the other end. And that way I could run the screws down that pencil line. And I won't have to guess where those joists are at. It's just gonna run right into the joist once I put those screws in. Make sure you're putting a sufficient amount of screws into this bottom piece. That way it doesn't come down, but don't push too hard to where the head of the screw is actually blowing through the plywood. So remember, not only are you hitting all the joists that are going from the backside to the front, you're gonna make sure that you're also screwing in screws to all the ends. Don't forget that there's wood there too, and the ends of this plywood need to be secured and installed with screws as well. I then went ahead and took an additional step. Now, again, this is not necessary. This is only your preference, but I wanted to go ahead and sand all this bottom portion down, the bottom piece of plywood. That way it's nice and smooth and it comes out a little lighter. Again, this was only my preference. After I had that bottom portion installed and everything was done with that, I went ahead and moved up to the top portion. Now, keep in mind, I made that marking on the end against that wall for where my joists were at. I still need to do the same thing with the opposite side. Now, one trick that you can use is just lining that straight edge up from one side where the wall's at to where your nails or screws are at the end of the joist. That way you know exactly where the joist is at. And it should be in the middle of your joist where you are, wherever you screwed in or nailed in your nails or your screws to the end of the joist. So I don't recommend standing on a ladder this way. However, I was comfortable with it, so that's the reason I was standing this way. So you want to make sure you get all your joists. You want to screw into all your joists. I got a little splinter on my hand right there. Don't forget your endings as well. Just like we did for the bottom side, the top side is the exact same. You have wood on top also. So screw in any piece that you could possibly find to make sure that everything is nice and secure. It doesn't really matter to what size screw you're using or nails, just make sure it's long enough to go through the actual plywood and into the joist. So again, inch and a half is always going to be sufficient. All right, so I didn't want to leave the screw holes exposed, so all I did was get a piece of 1x and I placed it against the ending portion of the frame, the one that's facing forward, and I'm just going to go ahead and cover up those screw holes with this. It's pretty simple to do, just get some clamps, clamp it into place, make sure that that bottom portion is very flushed up with the bottom portion of the plywood. Now, if I was thinking before I even purchased this piece of 1x here, I would have thought about making sure that I bought a piece that was wide enough that if I needed to trim it with a table saw, I could have done it to the exact size. However, I did not, so now I need to cut a piece to fill in the gap on top. Once you hit a couple nails in with the clamps in place, the 1x is going to hold up. Just finish it off. Make sure you're giving a good sufficient amount of nails on this. All I'm using are some 18 gauge nails. And as explained earlier, I needed to strip a piece of wood just to cover that top portion of the 1x we just installed. So I got the measurement and I used my table saw to make that cut. So here's the strip that I have to install. You can see that I still need to make another cut. It's just going to be cut off the same exact width as the one I'm installing up on top. I could have completely avoided doing all of this if I had just purchased a piece of wood that was wide enough, but I did not, so I had to work around it. Alright, so now getting on to the special features of this thing just to make it look good. I went ahead and installed some laminate wood flooring on top of this. Now, the only reason I wanted to do this, again, I didn't want to leave this plywood exposed. I wanted to have a nice smooth surface. Even though I'll be putting a mattress up on top, I still wanted to make sure it was completely smooth so that mattress won't get torn. So again, this is not necessary. It's something that I decided to do, and it was mostly decided because of the fact that I want to make this thing look really nice. But again, I'm not going to go through the whole process of how I install this laminate flooring. If you want, I did make a video regarding this specific type of laminate flooring and how to install it and all the tools that were used and why they're used in certain, you know, circumstances with this project. So please review over that and you'll see exactly why or what I did in regards to the tools I use and how I managed to install all of this stuff. So here is basically the ending portion of the wood flooring up on top, and once I have this last piece installed, you know, it's gonna be done up on top, except for the trim that needs to still go on. I don't know if it was meant to be or what the case was, but this last row here, I had to make no trim cuts whatsoever. For some reason, this laminate flooring fit perfect to the end, and I did not have to use my table saw to thin any down. So now that this last piece is getting installed, I'm pretty excited at this point because this project right here is almost complete. I do still need to place the trim, install the trim on this. You always want to use trim when installing wood flooring. All right, so like I said, the wood flooring just happened to be perfectly flushed up with that top piece of 1x I installed right there. Like I said, that was pure luck, but there's still one more step I need to take in order to complete this laminate flooring, and that's to install some wood glue on the end. So it doesn't matter if you're using exterior or interior wood glue. Anytime you're working inside, it really doesn't matter. However, the only reason I'm using exterior wood glue here is because that's what I purchased for this project and other projects before this, and I had it, so might as well use it. So all I did was run a bead of glue all the way down the front portion on the bottom side of that laminate flooring, the last row. I just ran a bead of glue all the way down. I'm going to clamp this thing down. I'm going to let that thing harden. I'm not going to touch this or play with this at all. Just let it harden, let it dry, and it should be good to go. So some people refer to trim as molding, baseboard, or trim itself. So whatever you decide to call it, that's what I'm using here. A lot of the times I call it baseboard, but you can use whatever size you want, whatever design you want, as long as it covers all the seams. Again, all I'm doing is making some 45 degree cuts at the corners, making the length, cutting the other 45 degree wherever needed, and installing them with some 18 gauge nails. The easiest way to install this or make your correct cuts is to make the 45 degree cut wherever needed. So whatever corner it has to hit a 45 degree at, make that cut first on your miter saw and then make your measurement to wherever you need to either have a 0 degree cut, basically straight up and down, or another 45 degree cut. So let's take this corner for example. For the long piece of trim that's on the back side, I would start at either corner. I would make a 45 degree cut on one side. I will then get my tape measure, measure out the distance from that corner to the other corner, and make my measurement, transfer that measurement onto the trim from that 45 degree cut I made to wherever the next 45 degree cut is I need to make. You don't want to make these measurements both at the same time, basically. You don't want to make two 45 degree cuts both at the same time. You want to make one, measure, cut the other one. All right, so now all this top portion of trim is installed. You can see that there's a gap at the front portion of the side pieces of trim. There's a reason behind that. I measured out the exact thickness of the front piece of trim that I'm going to be installing, just like this one here. I wanted to make sure that this trim is going to go as flush as possible and as close as possible to the trim on the side. All you have to do is make the measurement. If you have an extra piece, just cut it out and place it against that side piece of trim so you know your distance as far as you need to go to the front of it. Alright, so now all the trim is done. Basically, this framing portion is complete. What we need to install now is the ladder and the railing. Once I install both of those things, this thing is complete. So I obviously threw the boys up here. Well, I didn't throw them up there. Placed them up there very nicely. And they're loving it up there. Yeah, as you can see, this thing can hold two kids. It held me up there. I'm not sure if there was a video taken of that or not, but regardless, it held me up there with the two boys up there. This thing was not budging whatsoever. With all the installation of those lag bolts and all the blocking in the back and everything tied in with straps, this thing is rock solid and it is strong. And I promised the boys that I would try to get this ladder installed as soon as possible so they can at least go up and down themselves. And that's the next portion of this project. Alright, so this ladder right here was built by my dad. He took apart a bunk bed and made a ladder out of it. So basically just made some cuts and everything like that. So this is just made out of 2x6. It's pretty easy to make. The only thing that I need to do with this is make the angle that I want on it and make the cuts on the top and the bottom so it's flushed. So the first thing you want to do is find a comfortable angle for this ladder. So I figured I would try my speed square just to get it flush with the floor and make the line perfectly across on the bottom piece of the ladder, but my speed square was too thin to do that. So all I did was get a piece of 2x6, a block. It doesn't matter if you're using a 2x6 or a 2x4, whatever it is, just make sure it's thick enough so that there's no seams shown on the bottom of that ladder. Then you can make your line do the same thing with this side and the other side, and all we're going to do is cut it with a circular saw. Alright, so after you cut that with a circular saw, you're going to see that it's perfectly flushed up with the floor now, and it's at the same angle that you wanted at. Now we have to concentrate on the top part and just cut a little piece right off the top. Alright, so I decided that I wanted to use the 2x6 block again, thinking that it was going to work. However, it was going to take too much off this ladder. I didn't want to take that much off, so I went back to my speed square, and there's a little thin portion on the inside of that triangle portion off right where I'm marking this at. That is thin and thick enough to make a good cut, and it'll be flushed against that piece of 1x after I cut it with the circular saw. Do the same with the left and the right side. You can see this angle on this ladder right here. It's not straight up and down. It has a good angle on it, so when the kids are walking on this thing, you know, I'm not gonna fear that they're gonna fall backwards whatsoever. It's a good angle, it's a comfortable angle, and it's safe. Okay, as you can see, this was all I needed to take off the top portion of this ladder in order to make it flush against the 1x. Didn't need to take a lot off, just a small piece. Make sure that it's straight, and it should be flushed. So before I actually hook this ladder in with some straps I'm going to show you, just basically I'm going to use some rafter ties. I wanted to go ahead and find a stud that was behind the drywall. The reason behind this is that left portion of the ladder, I'm going to go ahead and still screw it into the stud. Now, you will not be able to screw in the entire left side of the ladder into the stud. You can only screw in whatever the ladder is actually going to be flushed up with that stud. So that's why I use a stud finder. and you pretty much mark out any areas you can on the wall and try your best to get as much of that ladder, hooked into that stud. Gives that extra safety feature. All right, so once you find wherever you can screw in screws into the ladder that's going to connect with that stud, just go ahead and use some deck screws. That's what I used, or whatever screws you have. Just make sure that they're solid and strong enough to hold this. I wouldn't recommend drywall screws, but it might do the job still. All right, once we have that ladder screwed in, these are the type of straps I want to use for the top portion. This is going to connect to the ladder and to that one by. Now you can see on the bottom of that strap, there's a corner that's still exposed. I do not want that. I want to make sure I'm bending this strap in, and I'm going to go ahead and screw it onto the ladder. Once it's bent, now you can either bend it with your hands or you could bend it at the time that you're screwing it in, but once it's bent on the ladder portion, right in the middle of that strap, then you can go ahead and screw them into that one by. Just make sure whatever size screws you're using, that you're actually using small enough that they're not going to puncture through the other side of that ladder. When you're going into that one by, use some longer screws because it's actually hitting that 2x6 behind it. And here are the boys trying out the ladder for the first time. This thing is strapped in very well. Strapped into the stud, it's strapped in with some ties, it's strapped into the 2x6. This thing is going nowhere. All right, it's time to finalize this project. The last thing I have to install is the rail. So, what I wanted to do was make sure I had a rail that was high enough that the boys couldn't roll over this thing if they were sleeping, but yet short enough to be able to fit a mattress over the rail when I want to put a mattress in there. Make sure you don't go all the way to the top because you'll never fit a mattress in. All right, so what I wanted to do was pretty much cut three pieces of 2x4s right at 16 inches. They're going to be exactly on 16 inches, and that'll be a high enough rail from the bottom portion of that frame to wherever the height of that rail I want to have it. Believe it or not, you can actually make 2x4 pieces of wood look very nice. All you got to do is sand it. You want to make sure you're sanding for two reasons. One, it's going to make it look nice, but two, most importantly, you're not going to have any splinters, especially when using the miter saw or any saw for that matter to cut this thing. You want to make sure there's no splinters at all. So I want to go ahead and pre-drill two screws into this piece of wood. Just be careful you're not going in too deep to puncture anything underneath this 2x4 at this time. You just want to start some screws. That way it makes it a lot easier to install this piece. Now for this first piece, you want to make sure it's flushed with the bottom, and you want to make sure that you're only screwing in that bottom screw. The reason being is because you can adjust it left or right after you check the level on it. So once you have that bottom screw screwed in, go ahead and put your level up against the side of it, and go ahead, once it's leveled in, go ahead and screw in that second screw, and you know that it's going to be perfectly leveled. Now obviously double check it. You always double check your work no matter what you're working on in case you need to unscrew that and adjust it. So the same exact thing applies with the next two. However, this time I installed the far right one first, before I installed this middle one. All I did was find the measurement between those two pieces of 2x4s, the one on the far left and the one on the far right, and I found the middle portion and I installed that 2x4 in the middle. What I have to do now is find my measurements between those pieces of 2x4s so I can cut a top portion and a bottom portion of 2x4 for this rail. Once you have your 2x4 piece cut to length and you know that it's going to fit between those two pieces of 2x4s that are going straight up and down, all you want to do is pre-drill a screw at an angle. Now remember that this 2x4 piece is going to be installed between the two pieces of 2x4s that are going up and down, that's 16-inch 2x4s. In order to do that, you need to make sure that you are angling a screw so that it goes in into this piece of 2x4 and into the piece that's going up and down. I wish I had a better angle for you at this time. I really thought the camera was showing this spot, but it wasn't. I already installed it, so I'm gonna have to show it to you after I install it, but you can pretty much get an idea that I am angling this screw down into that 2x4. All right, so here is the 2x4 installed. You can see that the screws were diagonal from the top portion into the 2x4 to the side of it that's going up and down. This is perfectly leveled off. Now, there's another way you could do this. Instead of doing it that way, you could screw straight into the 2x6 behind it. Now, even though you could have screwed into that 2x6 behind the bottom portions, You couldn't do that for the top portions, obviously, because there's nothing behind it. So that's why I had to show you the diagonal screw going into that. All right, so for my balusters, I just used some pieces of 1x and I cut them all at 16 inches. Now keep in mind, you don't want anything more than a 4-inch gap between balusters. So because of the fact that these are actually 3.5 inches wide, I can install one. I can move on to the next one by putting another 1x4 between them, and that's going to be used as my spacing all the way down. What you really have to make yourself concerned at is this first piece being perfectly leveled. The reason being is that I'm not going to have to level off any of the other balusters. Once I have this one perfectly leveled, I'm going to run this one, I'm going to screw it in, I'm going to put a dry fit of another 1x next to it clamped in, and then I'm going to install the second piece. Once you have that completely flush, the next piece that's going to go dry fitted against this first piece, it should be leveled off. That's why you have to make sure that your very first piece is leveled. All it takes is 2 screws per baluster, one on the top and one on the bottom. You can easily put 4, you can put 2 on the bottom, 2 on the top, whatever design you want to make, it does not matter. I'm only installing 1 on the bottom and 1 on top per baluster, and that's just my preference. Just make sure that whatever size screw you're using is not going to puncture through that 2x4 behind it. The bottom portion doesn't matter because it's going into the 2x6 that's concealed, but that top portion does matter. You don't want the point of the screw popping out. So once you have your first piece installed and you know that it's leveled, go ahead and dry fit this second piece in. Now the second piece is going to be used only as a spacer. Just clamp it into the 2x4 on top and then install your third piece. So here's a little bit better of an angle for the camera. You can see that the second piece that's in the middle, again, is just a spacer. And that's only dry fitted with a clamp. So all you have to do is put your third piece flushed up against that spacer and install that in. It should be perfectly leveled. You can check it with the level if you want. The only reason it wouldn't be leveled after using the spacer is if your spacer has any sort of bows on the side. So make sure your spacer is straight. So I went ahead and continued the same exact pattern, the same exact process all the way down until I got to the end. So you can see that every single spacing between each and every single baluster is 3.5 inches because I used that 1x4, which is actually 3.5 inches wide. I used it all the way down, so I'm not exceeding the 4-inch gap between the balusters. So you can either leave it this way, or you could take one extra step and top it off. I'm going to put a piece of 1x4 on the very top, flat on top of this rail. So I need to get my measurement and make my cut. Alright, so once I had my 1x4 cut to length, now just remember, you don't want to have it completely cut to the exact length. You want to make sure that there's an overhang. And the reason you want to make sure there's an overhang is because I'm not going to leave points on the end of this rail. I want to make sure that I'm going to make a circle around the top portion or the ending portion where it's near the ladder. So in order for me to do that, I need a couple things. I need a scriber or a compass, whatever you want to call it, my speed square, and some measurements. So again, this is a piece of 1x4. Now keep in mind, it's actually 3/4 inch by 3.5 inches. So you want to make sure you find the middle of that 3.5 inch mark, which is actually 1.75 or 1 3/4. Once you find that 1 3/4 marking, go ahead and make a line with your speed square because we're going to use our compass or our scriber and we're going to make a circle around the top portion. If you watched my how to build a deck for this playhouse, you will see that I installed the rails as well, and I did the same exact thing with that. So all I did was take my scriber, put that metal point right at the 1 1 3/4 mark where I have that line that I made with my speed square, and I find my distance with the pencil all the way to the side of the 1x4. Once you have that measurement with your scriber, just go ahead and follow it around. Make a half a circle. That's going to be the edge portion that's near the ladder. We're going to use a jigsaw to cut it out. So again, here's the top of the rail that I built when I was building the deck. It has the same exact round portion at the end of it. I'm just using this top rail just to be able to clamp in this 1x4, nothing else. I then went ahead and used my jigsaw and I followed the line. You follow the line, you have a perfect half circle on there. You shouldn't have any issue cutting this. A jigsaw is very easy to use. And just like anything else that you're cutting, you want to make sure that you're sanding it down. Just use a sander, go over the edge, whatever areas that jigsaw touched, and make sure that everything gets flushed up and nice around. Make sure there's no splinters on this area. Alright, so here's the piece of 1x4 that's dry fit on top. I just gotta find an area to where I actually want it to stay, and once I have it in there, I'm gonna go ahead and screw it in. So a couple things that you want to look at. You want to make sure that the end portion, the round area, it has a good enough overhang that it's not too flush with the end of the rail. It has a somewhat of an overhang. You also want to make sure that you're pretty satisfied with the right side and the left side of the rail that's hanging over the rail. Once you're satisfied, go ahead and clamp it in. The very first screw that you want to install is at either end, either the one that's near the ladder or the one that's near the wall. You don't want to start in the middle, but you do want your first screw to be at one of the ends. You want your second screw to be at the opposite end, and then you can work your way in the middle. So again, I started where the ladder was at, and then I moved to my second screw where the wall's at. That way, this thing does not move on you, and you know that it's going to be perfectly straight and where you left it clamped in. Once you have these two screws screwed in, you can remove the clamps and go into the middle. So you could have done so many different things with this rail. We could have used a router, we could have made some nice edges on it, we could have painted it. We could have done so many different things to this rail. I was pretty satisfied with the way it came out. The sanding just made it look wonderful. All the 2x4s were sanded down. Every single 2x4 that I cut, every single piece of baluster, all the 1x4s were all sanded down. It's very important to make sure that these are sanded down strictly for because of the fact that you don't want to have any splinters. These kids are going to be placing their hands on this. They're going to be running around with some toys on top of it. You just don't want them to run their hand and get a splinter in it. I mean, that would be devastating to them. All right, so the rail is complete. You can see how easy this actually was. It took some measurements, it took some cuts, but in all honesty, it was an easy project to do. It just actually completed the remainder of the bed, and now the kids are going to be completely safe unless they throw themselves over this entire thing, which I don't see them doing. All right, guys, thanks for watching this video. I know that it was long. It was a learning process for me, and I really hope it was for you as well. If you guys are planning on doing something like this, you know, don't just use my idea. You can use it if you want, but like I said, to go around and ask other people, look at other people's ideas, look at other people's videos, and just make it into your own. I didn't really look at anybody else's videos for this. I looked at their ideas regarding, you know, support systems and stuff like that, but I wanted to make it a little bit different. I didn't want any beams on the bottom of this. That way the kids can have enough room on the bottom to play still. But I did make this into my own. Little by little, step by step, I said, you know what, I want to do this, I want to do that. And I just basically made it as I went. Do the same for yourself, you know, make it into your own. It's always more enjoyable to look at and know that you did it yourself and it was from your own thoughts. So again, thanks for watching. Please subscribe and like this video if it helped any. Thanks and take care.